Click on the subscribe button to subscribe to our channel. Press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update.
Hi friends, I am Pratham Kaushik, rank 5 this year. I am happy to be here. I'll be happy to guide people, to guide all my friends to achieve their dreams, just as I have been guided earlier by the toppers of the earlier years. So I feel very obliged, indebted and grateful to be here. So I'll start from my journey for the first few minutes, and then I'll take up the major issues that were my strength. Essay is one of them, ethics case studies, how to write expressive answers, and then my friend Abhijit, this year ranked 19, he'll take up the GS prelims part. I think most of you are here for him only, because the prelims is approaching. Anyway, so my journey begins in college. I was in Punjab Engineering College, Chandigarh. I am a graduate of Materials and Metallurgical Engineering. I graduated in 2015. So in my third year of college, I thought of seriously appearing for the civil services. I didn't know anything about the preparation, so just randomly heard that people read the Hindu. So I picked up a copy of the Hindu and I read it. And I saw that I could not understand even a single sentence. So that is a problem I think all of you must have faced the first time you have read the Hindu. I picked up dictionary, I referred to some word meanings, finally was able to read the Hindu at least in 1.5 hours or 2 hours. So that was that, the Hindu was my beginning of the preparation. Then during college it was not very deeply studied, didn't put in much effort. So after my graduation I came to Delhi and started preparing seriously. I devised a strategy for preparation using prelims and mains, both of them collectively. So there was no such thing as preparing separately for prelims and then separately for mains. That is the basic thing. Then I found out that the syllabus is very vast. So how to cover such a vast syllabus and that too very efficiently? So what I did was, I had never looked at the syllabus as a whole. I divided the syllabus into small parts. For example, in GS1, I divided the syllabus as, obviously UPSC has a clear demarcation as well, that art and culture part is there, world history part is there, sociology part is there, and geography part is there. So I did that basically so that I could cover the syllabus more efficiently. And for prelims, I'll take up all the matters separately as well, and then I'll tell you which sources did I refer to and what was my method of preparation. So basically what happened was, in 2016 I failed in prelims. So it was my first attempt, 2016. I failed, and I did not expect to fail right at the prelims stage. I thought I would be able to write mains. But at that time I was very shattered, very depressed, did not know what to do, could not find out what was my problem as far as prelims was there. So I took up the prelims question paper. I took a 1 month break first of all, 1 month break, gathered myself. I took up the prelims question paper, and I'll suggest that to you, all people who have failed prelims at least once, it is for them, that you pick up the question paper and you find out the areas where you could not perform. So my two bit on prelims is that he'll deal prelims because he is a topper right through in both of his prelims. So my two bits are that I picked up the paper of the prelims 2016 and I found out where did I lack. So there was, it was clearly visible to me once I picked up the paper. So in my case it was, I marked all the government schemes wrong because I had not prepared them. I marked all the two reports. In fact, I even marked the ease of doing business report wrong on 2016 question paper. And I marked almost all the organizations wrong as well. So these two, three parts, the government schemes, the organizations, reports and their reports. All these three areas. So basically they covered almost 10 to 12 questions. So, and 10 to 12 questions in prelims are make a huge difference. So I focused on those areas, especially in my next prelims, and then I was able to mark in this prelims almost all the government schemes right, all the reports right, and all the organizations right. So that was my part to analyze your prelims paper, because prelims failure is one thing that will not even allow you to test your mettle. So there are many of my friends are there who failed prelims once, twice, thrice, and then even they then the one time they got the chance to write mains, they cleared it. I am one of them. Two, three of my other friends are there jinhone mains ka mauka milte hi final list mein apna naam liya. To ye bahut crucial hai, because prelims is definitely a big hurdle. So do not falter at that. Analyze your paper and you will find out ki aap kahan pe lacking hain, aur specifically aapko wahin pe hi kaam karna hai. Now that was prelims bit. So after that, after prelims 2017, so I was not prepared well enough with geography. My optional is geography. So I had gone through the syllabus, I had read it even twice, in fact twice or thrice maybe, but I was not very confident. Similarly, for static portion, I referred all the NCRTs and I was confident for mains. But for current affairs, basically GS2 and GS3 were, I did not know any source from where to prepare GS2 and GS3. And after prelims, it was definitely a big hurdle. So I referred to current affairs materials, mainly of Vision IAS and Forum, sir. I attended classes at Forum. These two were my main sources for GS2 and GS3. I joined the Vision test series, the mains Vision test series, but did not write many tests, although I will not recommend that to you, because I think all of us have certain special abilities because of which we are here, because of which we are fighting out in this examination. So you have to identify which special ability do you have, on whose strength, on whose basis you are here. So for me, that was my analytical skill, my answer writing skill. I was pretty confident that if I have bare minimum material for any question, I'll be able to write a good answer. So I did not put in much effort in answer writing. I put more effort in reading and revising. I did not refer to many sources. My sources are very, very limited. I did not study for many hours. Obviously, I studied for 3, 4, 5 hours regularly, and then when prelims was approaching, my sitting went to even more than 10 hours. I used to go to the library in the morning and stay there till night. And even between prelims and mains, the first month was used to pick up momentum, because right after prelims I was very exhausted. So you'll also feel exhausted after the prelims, because you have to mug up so many things, and in the week preceding the prelims, your brain is working at your full efficiency. And it is not possible to maintain that efficiency right then, right next day after the prelims. So take a break for 1, 2, 3 days, and then start preparing for mains again. The initial speed for preparation of mains will be obviously limited, but as you pick up momentum, you'll keep on increasing your efficiency, and you'll peak at the right time. The most crucial part for me was to peak at the right time, and I peaked exactly in those 7 days, those 6, 7 days of the mains examination. So my journey is not as you should not draw a conclusion that my journey was very easy and it was like a bed of roses. No, it was a bed of thorns. In 2016, when I failed, I was very depressed. It was very difficult to come out of that, because I was not expecting to fail. Most of my friends cleared prelims, and that is definitely a baggage. But then I again started preparing. I changed many rooms. I thought this environment is not good for me. This environment is not good for me. I changed many rooms. I went back home. Ki I'll prepare from home. Toppers prepare from home. Delhi mein mahol achha nahi hai. Depressing mahol hai, and all this. I have gone through all that. And the most important thing, because look, people will tell you about knowledge. People will tell you that read this book, read that book. People will tell you about test series, write those answers, essay likho, vaise likho. All these things are very, very vastly, very extensively, exhaustively available on the internet, and some of your friends, your seniors can also tell you that. But one thing, and I am not telling anything different, I am telling what I faced. One thing that I want to tell you people is that if you believe in yourself, and trust me, it is not a cliche line, it is what that you should incorporate in your life. That should be there. Belief is the most basic thing. You do not know answer writing, you learn it. You do not know geography, history, you learn it. You have not read your optional, you learn it. You'll read it again. You'll read it in the next attempt. That is not a problem. The problem is belief. The problem is attitude. We keep on struggling. I have seen people who keep on struggling for 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. They have written 4 mains, 5 mains. And I'm not undermining their effort. They are very hardworking people, more hardworking than the toppers. But still they are unable to achieve success as good as the toppers have achieved. Because you see people, in fact I am here in my second attempt, people are topping the exam, rank 1 in first attempt as well. There are many toppers. So definitely there is an element of luck, I do not deny that. But the most important element is of belief. It is of attitude. All of you are sitting here, but only few of you are going to make it. And the difference will be not in content. You are as good as the person sitting next to you as far as content is there. But the positive attitude, the spirit that you will fight it out, the belief that you will make it, is going to make a difference. For me, that was the only factor that made a difference. So what happened right before my mains was that I had not prepared geography before prelims, not extensively. I found it very difficult after prelims. So one advice on my part will be prepare your optional before prelims. I mean, there is not much time now, 30 days are left. And those of you who have not prepared prelims, who have not prepared geography till now, are definitely going to face difficulties after prelims. But there is a solution. You put in more effort. I did that because I was not well prepared enough with geography. Then the most important thing about belief which I was talking was 20 days before my mains exam, 7th of October was the date, I had not read enough for the last 4-5 days. I was feeling very dejected. I thought that I will not be able to make it through the mains this time, and now that I have made it through the prelims, let's focus on the next attempt. So 20 days before mains, I thought of focusing on the next attempt. And I think most of you have perhaps gone through that feeling at least once. Those who have written mains must have gone through that feeling. And there is something that I want to tell you is nearly 12,000-13,000 people write mains. And we see that the competition is very fierce. Actually, it is not so. Out of those 12,000 people, 2,000 give up right before the mains. 2,000 people give up before the mains. They think that they are going to attempt mains just for the sake of attempting, just for the sake to have a feel. 2,000-3,000 people are like that only. And the rest of the people, the 8,000-9,000, the fight is among them. And in fact, even among them, most of the in those 8,000-9,000, around 2,000 people will give up after GS1 or after GS2. So at the end of optional, the fight I think is among 5,000-6,000 people at max, because those 6,000 people have had put in their full effort into the mains exam, because the rest of the people somewhere faltered when belief, when self-confidence, when the spirit came to the matter. So one thing that I want you people to learn from me is the warrior mode. So jaise Zakir Khan bolta hai na, bhai tumhara sakht londa wala. Similarly, in this examination, bhai should be warrior. You should be a warrior. The mains examination, treat it as a battle. So when I entered the examination hall, I was in a warrior mode. I was like, I have put in so much effort. So I put in 2-3 years of effort. Look, there is never going to be, to be honest with you, I had no feeling before my mains examination that I am going to be a topper, or even if I am going to make it into the list. I was feeling just like you, just as anxious, just as vulnerable. The feeling was similar to all the other aspirants. But as soon as I entered the exam, I thought that now I could not study anymore. The mains exam, I'll have the question paper in my hand in 10 minutes. How can I study now? So what I had read, I had confidence on it. That is one most important thing. So the warrior mode is that you enter the mains exam, you forget everything else, and everything else includes all your insecurities. You forget all your insecurities, you enter the examination hall, you take the questions on face value, you have belief and confidence. Do not think that you have not read this question, so will not attempt it, especially in mains. Because in geography optional, when I was handed the paper, I got to know that I did not know 100 or 120 marks, or in fact 150 marks out of the 250 marks of paper. In fact, out of 400. Out of 400, I knew only 100 or 150. So basically, the 250 marks that I should have attempted, I knew only half of them, and I also knew that by attempting half of the paper I'll not be able to make it. So the key was to attempt the whole paper, and at that moment I gathered myself and I thought that despite having read so much, if I am not able to answer these questions, if I do not know these questions, then how can the person sitting next to me know? He is not a superman, na? He is also a simple aspirant like me. He has also read all these things, which I have read. He has not read, he has not prepared something out of the world. He is just like you. So you must have belief, you must have faith that whatever questions you face in the examination hall, you are really equipped enough. All the people who clear prelims are equipped enough to answer all the questions of mains. The difference lies in their approach. The difference lies in the fact that some of them actually believe that they can answer the questions, and the rest of them think that they'll answer the question next time. And I was among them also. I was among those people who thought before mains, who thought to skip the mains, to give their best, not to skip, I mean, to skip in mind. To say that I'll perform better next year because I'll have one more year. So this cycle is not going to end. So at that moment, what helped me was one of my friend. He was also going to write the mains exam. And I went to him and I said, I'll not be able to write the papers because I do not know anything. Then he said, if you do not know anything, how did you clear your prelims? So that definitely means that you know something. It is just your vulnerabilities. It is just your anxiety that is putting this thought into your head that you do not know anything. So at that moment, he chalked out a 20-day strategy for me. That was basically a revision strategy, how to pick up the mains 365, how to pick up the PT 365, which I had done earlier, to revise, how to revise. Because in mains, I think you use only the pointers from your prelims examination. There is no such thing as different preparation for mains. Whatever you had read for prelims, you will use that as examples in your answers. So he told me, he motivated me, and the result is here. I wrote mains with my whole conviction, and that is my warrior mode originated on the 7th of October, 20 days before mains. At that time I was in that mode, ki let UPSC come with all its might, and let me go with all my might, and let's see the fierce battle that happens there. So, and I'm glad that I emerged victorious, and that is not because of content, not because of expression, not because of anything else, just because of the feeling, just because of the mindset which I carry to the examination hall. So that is the most important thing I want you people to derive from me. I'm not more intelligent than you. Most of you who are sitting here are more knowledgeable, more intelligent than me. In fact, more hardworking. I never worked as hard. I could not work hard. I had a backache problem, so I could not sit for long hours. But the difference that I was able to generate was of the mindset. So that is one thing. So now mains was over, I got good result. So it was my first interview. So it was very interesting, very exciting to prepare for the interview. And there are many interview guidance programs available. But in my opinion, you cannot prepare for the interview. You cannot prepare for your personality. You only get to know your personality. So you can develop your personality, that is a separate thing, but you cannot prepare your personality in 1 month. You just get to know who you are in that 1 month. I had 1 month for interview preparation after the mains result. So in that 1 month, I tried to know who I was, what my belief system was. I got to list down those things concretely in the form of words, so that if I am asked certain personality based questions in the interview, what will I answer? All these things. So the preparation for UPSC interview starts on the day one. The preparation for UPSC mains starts on the day one. You decide to prepare for your prelims as well. So you have to develop that and that mindset, that warrior mindset will help you in interview as well. Because you will see that the interview questions, you'll see that in mock interviews, they'll throw you a question and you'll answer it. They'll throw you another question and you'll answer it. They'll throw you third question and you'll say, sir, sorry, sir, I do not know. Then they'll throw another question. But in actual interview, it is not like that. The actual interview is just a conversation that brings the best out of you, that brings the your true self out. So for that also, I'll say that your personality and your attitude are the most important things, because most of my friends who are preparing along with me and who could not make it, they did not lack anywhere in knowledge or content or even personality. They lacked in their conviction, the conviction to themselves, not the conviction to studies. They lacked in their belief and their mindset. And I think, and one more thing that I want to make sure is that I am just a mediocre person. I am just a normal guy who was sitting right next to you 10 days back. I was searching for test series in the of prelims in the market very frantically. I was very anxious ki kuch nahi aata hai, agar is bar I do not make it to the list, I will not be able to clear prelims. I had not revised the current affairs for the last 4-5 months. So I am a very normal guy. So basically what I felt was the void that we feel is between us and the toppers, us and UPSC, us and being an IAS, is that in our mind. The void is in our mind. The gap is in our mind. There is no real gap. People like you will make it to IAS. People like me made it to IAS. I was just a normal guy. So now when I am, now that I have achieved such a rank, all of my friends are more confident. Why? Because they have seen somebody who was sitting right there, right next to them, who was preparing along with them, make it to such a level. So that generated belief and confidence in them, that gave them a feeling that it is very much possible. Ask yourself, do you really think is it possible? Because I did not think. I thought that I was preparing for civil services. Anybody who asked me, what are you doing? So I was, I am preparing for civil services. But I did not have that real conviction, that real feeling that one day I'll be able to make it. I did not have that. So after I have made it, now in hindsight, I think that yes, there was that feeling somewhere, but that was not very prominent. So the most important thing is to have that, to feel the connect. I want you people to feel that, and again, it is not a cliche. I want you people to feel that if I can make it, you also can make it, because I am just as good as you. It is just that my time has come now that I am here. Your time will come in next attempt. Your time will come later. It's the difference only of time. If you have the same conviction, if you have the same belief, and definitely you need to give in hard work. I am not saying ki motivation. I am not saying ki you wake up in the morning and you go to the YouTube and you see video lectures of motivation for 2 hours. I'm not suggesting that. I am suggesting the motivation that drives you from within. So, and obviously it is not all the game of motivation. Aisa nahi hai ki main bahut motivated hu but main kuch padhta nahi hu, so I'll make it. Obviously that is not going to help. Motivation is the icing on the cake. The cake definitely will be your content, your expression, your hard work that you have put in there. All those times when you have failed, all those times, all those lows during the preparation, all those things will help you to build the cake. But icing will be definitely motivation, definitely the belief. So that will make other people and you, that will make a difference between other aspirants and you when you become a topper. That is the only difference in my opinion. So that was my whole journey. Now I'll deal separately because Abhijit will be taking up prelims. So I'll take up ethics and essay and expression in answer writing. These three main topics with that I'll deal with. So first of all, to essay. The essay paper is the first paper in the mains examination. So your performance in essay, your feeling after writing those nearly 2,500 words, that feeling is going to carry with you for the next 6 days, for the rest of the paper. So that is very crucial, one important part. The second is, essay is a very high scoring paper. Somebody having more knowledge, somebody having worked harder than me might be able to score more in GS. And the difference that he'll create in four GS papers, let's say I could score 400 and somebody who has topped could score 450. He could create a difference of 50 marks in four GS papers. You can create a difference of 50 marks in one essay paper. You can score 160 and your competitors might score 110, 120. So essay is a very crucial paper, the preparation of which is often neglected. And I did not write a single essay before my mains exam. That is also true. And still I am lecturing here on essay. And that is true. I am not essay nahi ki sab topper se hi bolte hain, toh maine bhi aake yehi bola. No, not that. I did not write a single essay before my mains exam. I did not strategize for a single essay. Once it just happened on the day of Diwali, 10 days before mains, that I discussed a single essay with my friend how to write the essay. And he gave me some insights how to write the essay. I used those insights and I credit him. Definitely, he helped me in writing a good essay. But the overall thing, and still I am lecturing on essay because I think that I knew what UPSC wanted out of you in an essay, and that is why I was able to score good marks, hopefully abhi marks aaye nahi hai, good marks in essay paper, and that is why I was able to write a good essay, after which I was feeling very very confident ki bahut acha essay maine likha hai. So, and that is because I know what UPSC expects, demands from an essay. So first of all, you should know that. So What is the demand of the essay paper? It is as good as an interview. It is as good as a written interview. They give you few topics. It is your choice to pick up the topic. It is your choice to choose the words which you are going to use to explain your thoughts. So all the choice lies with you. All the choice lies with you and how you use, how you exercise that choice to make an impression on the examiner. So requirement of the essay paper is clear. In fact, I think shayad UPSC writes as well demand of the essay paper is a clear thought, clear expression and all these things. So this I think you all know what is the demand of the essay paper. It is a clear expression, clear thought, how to analyze a certain topic and all those things. Keeping that in mind, I have to be clear in, look, there is, your essay should be as simple as it would be of a fifth class student. Do not think that you are going to write an essay for the IAS examination, that is some very big thing. No, it should be as simple as a fifth class student. Practically, the essay should be very easy to comprehend. The examiner is not sitting there to check how many difficult English words you know. He is not sitting there for that. He's sitting there to check your expression. So for essay paper, I'll suggest you to write few essays, because I think answer writing or writing skills or expression were inherent in me. They were built during my schooling, they were built during my college. So that is why I did not require any specific preparation to develop writing skills. But if you feel, look, every one of us has different skill set. So I had good writing skill as my skill set. Some of you might have good content as your skill set. So I developed content because I had good writing skill. if you feel that you have good content, you develop a writing skill. So I'll take up the essay I wrote in the examination. I wrote on the destiny of a nation is shaped in its classrooms. I wrote on that essay. One other thing that I just came to my mind was, people have created certain myths around essays. Okay, one of them is, do not take up the cliche topics like education or women, because people are so extensively prepared on these topics that you are never going to beat them. It is not true. You write the essay which you are most comfortable with, except the essay that you have read in your optional. Because there was an essay, on agriculture, on farmers as well. I have geography as my optional. I was tempted to write that essay, but I did not write that because geography was my optional. Or when you write something from your optional, you do not know what you are writing. You just write it as a GS answer, as a geography optional answer. You might write it like that. You might use some jargons which are very normal to you, which might seem ki to sabko pata hoga, but the examiner who is going to check might be a professor of English language or might be some bureaucrat or some other professor. Definitely he'll not be a professor of your optional. So that is a crucial thing. You avoid that essay which you have read in your optional, but you attempt that essay in which you have a bare minimum content. A threshold content is required. Not that you know, you must, it is not that you, if you, even if you, it is not that if you know 1,000 words, then only you will write, be able to write 1,000 words. No, you must know only 10 bullet points. If you know 10 bullet points about an essay, attempt that, you will be able to write 1,000 words on that. So I picked up that essay. Now coming to the requirement of for the essay paper. So the requirement is requirement from a good essay. Any article you read in the Hindu, you'll see that there is a good introduction. You just go today, you pick up the Hindu, you read the article, and you will see the last para and the first para of the article basically give you everything you do not have to read in between. So the body of the essay is the least important. Introduction and conclusion are the most important. One thing where we falter is we start writing an essay, and when we reach the last page, then we decide what is going to be our conclusion. That is a wrong approach. You decide beforehand what is going to be your conclusion, what is going to be your introduction. You have to decide that before writing an essay. So for writing an essay, we get 1.5 hours. So for the first half hour, you must divide it like, first of all, you just pick up the topic, choose the topic in the first 5 minutes, 3 minutes, and then you keep on brainstorming. You keep writing down, you keep noting down the points which pop up in your head, and you just note them down randomly, no structuring. Just write those points randomly on your last page of the answer booklet for the first 10-15 minutes. That is all about brainstorming. After the 15 minutes of brainstorming, you will have certain points, 10-15-20 points regarding that essay. And then you try to structure the points ki ye social headings mein ja raha hai, ye economic headings mein ja raha hai, ye environmental headings mein ja raha hai, ye achha introduction ho sakta hai, ye achha conclusion ho sakta hai, like that. And in the next 5 to 10 minutes, after brainstorming, your mind will be widened for that topic, and it will be easier for you to think of an introduction or and a conclusion. So in the first 25 to 30 minutes, you think over your essay. After that, you start writing. So I wrote for 1 hour and I thought for half an hour. So as far as the structure goes, the introduction should be something that will give the examiner an insight. What are you going to write in the rest of your essay? So introduction is, people start with an anecdote, people start with some data as well, people start with some definitions as well, but I think that introduction must be the gist, what is going to come, what is awaiting the examiner. So in one of my essays, in this essay I wrote a story, I'll tell you. When I read this statement, destiny of a nation is shaped in its classrooms, so I thought of a story of B.R. Ambedkar, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. So I wrote like that. A 10-year-old child was standing outside a school in rural Maharashtra, waiting to enter the school. And he could not, because of the social stigmas attached with the education of the classes, of the depressed classes. So, and then one teacher came out of the school, admitted that child to the school, and that classroom gave India its destiny, the Constitution of India. So that was roughly my introduction, and I think that is a catchy introduction. That is an introduction which will give the examiner the feeling that yes, the student has a well thought student. He has thought of a certain innovative thing which is not available there in the books, but that is definitely very relevant to the topic, and that basically explains what this statement demands from you. So, and after that I picked up the primary education, secondary education, and not like ki primary education mein ye problems hain, ye solutions hain, no, not that. The role that primary education plays, how it builds the moral character of the students, how it builds good health for the students, how those students, when they enter their professional careers, how they shape the destiny of the country, how among one of them there will be a prime minister, among one of them there will be the governor of the RBI, among them there will be a president, among them there will be the chairperson of ISRO. So all these things I wrote in the essay, and then few quotes are there. So quotes should not be used to be thrown upon on the examiner. Do not throw upon quotes on the examiner. Use the quotes to substantiate. So what I did was I picked up the editorials of Yojana. Okay, so I picked up 12 Yojanas, Yojana magazines before the essay paper. I tore the editorials, and Yojana generally begins with a quote. The editorial of Yojana generally begins with a quote, and there is one quote which might be mentioned in the write-up. So those 12 quotes, or might be 15-16 quotes, was what I learned, no more than that. And I thought, if a topic comes in which I could use those quotes, I'll use them, but I'll not force them on any topic. I'll not do that. So luckily I read somewhere in the Yojana only, I read that education is the most important weapon with which you can change the world. So I had that quote, but I did not start my essay with that quote. I used that quote to substantiate the 2-3 pages which I had written earlier. So I used that quote on my 4th, 5th, 6th page, like that. So you do not throw the quote on the examiner, you throw your insights of the topic, and then give an examiner a quote to substantiate that, look, great people also have said this. So you do that. So in this way you'll make out the points, and also the points can be made like suppose there is a topic on education, any topic, you just have some subheadings ready with you for essay paper. You have some subheadings like we see environmental, legal, law and order, all the ministries. You look up which ministries the government of India has, and you note down the heading, the title of the ministry. All those things are going to be your subheadings for GS papers, for essay papers. I feel that UPSC has given answers in the syllabus itself. Whenever you are writing, whether in GS 1, 2, 3 essay, even in your optional, if it is a humanities optional, so you look for diversity. Because what is expected from you when you become a civil servant is diversity. One day you will be handling, yesterday we were at DOPT and the minister said to us that it might be possible that in one meeting you will be handling excise department. So how much liquor is sold, how much revenue is generated, and in the next meeting only you will be handling prohibition. Why liquor vents are not closed down? Why is still the illegal liquor selling? What are you doing? So basically two opposite things you have to deal with in consecutive meetings. So that is what is expected from a bureaucrat, to have diversity in his opinion. So to write answers, you just refer the ministries or the UPSC syllabus. You refer the syllabus. Syllabus is very, very clearly expressing the subheadings. One, culture. The first topic for GS1 is culture. So anything you write, include a cultural angle, include a historical angle. Then the second is obviously history. Third is sociology. You include a sociological angle. You include an angle of women. You include an angle of women. Angle of women. You include an angle for the age, for the children, for the depressed classes, for the tribes. So these 4 or 5 things, I am not saying you fit it in there. I am just saying if it is relevant, you write that. So this is how you will develop the content. This is how you will develop the expression, which will help you in essay paper and in all the GS papers, and help me in geography as well. So then I came to my second essay. It was the essay on the fulfillment of new woman in India is a myth. So again, I thought of a story, some story kept popping up in my head. So I thought it will be repetitive. When in the first essay I have given an impression ki I am a creative guy, I am an innovative guy, why to repeat that same thing? Why to look? Because of various coaching institutes that are helping us in clearing this examination, what has happened is that we have a fixed set of writing, fixed way of writing. Wherever you go for answer writing, wherever you go for essay writing, people will spoon feed you. Even I am spoon feeding you. This is wrong. People will spoon feed you, write like that, write like that, write like that, and all of you will write like that. Nobody is saying to you that be creative, be innovative. So the second essay, I thought of, I'll not write a story. That will not be creative, that will not be innovative. So I just thought of ki, why the topic? Okay, one more important thing. Always think for essay and for GS, always think why the question is asked. Your first thought should be why the question is asked, and the answer will be your introduction. People yesterday asked me, what should be the introduction? We do not know data. I did not know any data. I did not write any data in my examination, in my answer papers. You need not write any data. You look up one very important source for me was Vision IAS test series ka model answer material. The answers are very good, and you look at those answers and you will see there is no data. So you don't need any data to write your introduction or your body or your conclusion or to substantiate. No, you are appearing for the civil services. Your job is to analyze. Your job is not to compile. You will get people who will compile the data for you, and then you will analyze that data to take up any policy or to take up any step to make any intervention. So your job is not data collection. So do not do that. Just ask yourself why the question is there. So you'll get what will be the answer. Any question, why does it come? Because of its importance. If you know the importance, that is your introduction. So for essay, I did that thing only. I thought why the essay is there. Fulfillment of new woman is a myth. Why is the essay there? Because there is the idea of a new woman. So why is there an idea of a new woman? Because there is something presently, or there was something historically that is not very conducive for the situation of women, for situation of women. So I wrote that this is your topic is farce. This is wrong. We have had women in historical times, in Rig Vedic times, Gargi and all those things that I read in prelims, that the content comes from prelims only. So I wrote that. You can also call it an historical way of approaching the essay, past, present and future. That is also a good way to write an essay. You mention the historical things, you mention the present, and you give up an optimism, you give up a future, a good future. So that I wrote, and then I wrote ki, in fact, eventually I wrote ki, the very statement that fulfillment of new woman in India is a myth, is a challenge to the new woman of India. It is a challenge to those women who have made it this far, to women like our honorable ministers like Sushma Swaraj and the defense minister, I forgot her name. Nirmala Sitharaman. So it is a challenge to women like them. The very statement of the essay is a challenge to them. And I think such type of ideas definitely have helped me in getting good marks in essay. So the summary of the essay, the summary of all the strategy for essay should be innovative, be creative, do not be haphazard, think what you are going to write. People have been using diagrams and data tables and maps in essay as well. I did not do that. Personally, I think that you should not do that. You must write, you must express through your words only in essay paper. So if you are if you think of all the angles, if you think diversely, if you think from a positive perspective, look, positive state of mind is very important. What we do is we are generally very critical of the government. Generally, if you talk to your friend, you will say ki kya ho raha hai, kuch bhi nahi ho raha hai. देखो स्वच्छता अभियान चलाया राजेंद्र नगर में तो अभी भी गंदगी पड़ी है. सो दिस इज अ नेगेटिव माइंडसेट. यू सी वन राजेंद्र नगर और वन ड्रेन दैट पासिस फ्रॉम करोल बाग, यू सी कि ये तो अभी भी गंदा है. यू सी दैट, बट यू डू नॉट सी ऑल द हार्ड वर्क, ऑल द गुड वर्क दैट हैज बीन पुट इन बाय द गवर्नमेंट. बिकॉज इट इज एनी गवर्नमेंट स्कीम. वी आर ए कंट्री ऑफ 1.25 करोड़ पीपल. सो एनी इनिशिएटिव दैट इज that is being started will not yield results in one day or two days. So that, because of that, we should not develop a negative mindset. We must be with a positive mindset, because we are going to join the government. So you are going to be the part of those people who are working for the benefit of the people. So always keep a positive mindset. Always give an optimistic solution. Always do not write only problems. Everybody knows problems. Nobody is expecting you in mains to write about problems. Any GS question, any essay question you are going to answer, always write problems with solutions. Do not leave it at problems only. That will be a negative impression on the examiner. Okay, so this is all about essay. Rest will later have a question answer session as well, in which you can ask your specific queries for essay as well. Now to ethics case studies. So the approach of essay can very well help you, but whatever I have just delivered can very well help you in ethics case studies also. So what happens in ethics paper is that we get very less time. The paper is lengthy. The paper, few people are able to do that. Few people are able to frame answers. But I think most of the people write in ethics paper what they actually think. So you cannot frame your answers. So what you can do is you can frame your mind. You can frame your mind to think ethically during your preparation. Look, why did UPSC introduce the ethics paper? To check the personality. UPSC did not introduce the ethics paper to check how many ethical theories have you read. UPSC did not introduce the paper for that. The paper is to check your personality again. Essay and ethics, both are there for the personality part only. So for case studies, you actually put yourself in that situation. You do not approach it like a question. You approach it like a genuine problem which you are going to face eventually if you become a part of the government. And you will see, you will not be extremely ethical and you will not be extremely unethical. As a government servant, you are expected to find realistic solutions that will help in the welfare of the people, and not at the cost of you. It should, for example, the ethics case study this year was, if you are going for an interview and you see that a mother and child are lying on the road, so what will you do? So most of the people I know projected themselves to be ethical by writing, humanity and life is more important, life is more crucial, I'll skip my interview. How many of you will actually do that? I think nobody. So by writing that, you are eventually giving an impression to the examiner that this person is lying to me in the examination. When he becomes a civil servant, he'll lie to the people whom he is going to serve. He'll lie to the government. He is going to be a corrupt officer. Look, despite giving a positive answer, you are giving an impression that he is going to be a corrupt officer. So do not do that. Do not be the utopian, the ideal scenario. Do not be that. Be realistic. Be true to yourself. What will you do? And do not definitely write ki, let them lie on the road, let them keep lying on the road, I'll go for my interview because I want to be an IAS officer. No, not that. So what I did was, I stay in Rajinder Nagar, interview is in UPSC building. So I imagined myself in that situation. And as soon as I thought of an accident, the image of the Ram Manohar Lohia Hospital, RML Hospital, popped up in my head. So I thought there must be a hospital on the way. So I wrote that I'll search for the hospital on the way to the UPSC building or to the building where I am having my interview. And that is definitely the best way to save time, to save life, and to save your life as well, because you'll be able to give the interview. So I wrote on those lines, explaining why this is the best solution, explaining what will be the merits of the solution and what will be the demerits. Definitely you have to explain a demerit. So I wrote merits of this case, that I'll be able to attend the interview. You cannot shun your responsibilities as an administrator. So if you see a person and a child lying there, you cannot just call 100 and I did my job. You cannot shun your responsibility. You have to take them to the hospital. So the people, according to me, the people who wrote that I'll call my friends, I'll call my relatives, and they'll come and they'll pick up the injured. That, in my opinion, is not a good way to approach this. Because if you have come across a problem, you are going to solve them. Because as an administrator, you will do that. As an administrator, you will not call your relative ki aao aur mera kaam kar do, because mere ko kahin aur important jagah jana. You will not do that. So similarly, in all other case studies, you imagine yourself actually in that situation and you be realistic. And in being realistic, you do not do anything unethical. For example, I remember a friend. Last year there was a case study of domestic violence. Your boss was hitting his wife, and you just by chance encounter you came to know that. And one of my friends answered that I'll talk to my boss, and if the problem is genuine, I'll not do anything. So if the problem is genuine, you are allowed to hit your wife. He wrote that in the ethics paper. And obviously he did not get a very good score. How can he get a good score? So that is not being realistic. That is not being realistic. Wrong is wrong. So here, even if at the cost of your job, even if you have to lose your job, you will definitely save the woman, because domestic violence cannot be tolerated at any cost. So be realistic, but also be ethical. So you have to find a good blend of them. And the expression for case studies, now we come to that. How to express what I have told you, how to write an answer, how to think of an answer. Now how to express that answer. So generally the questions clearly give you an instruction ki what should be your strategy, what should be your two, three options that you have, and merits and demerits of all of them. The question in ethics case studies asks different approaches to the solution. So if they are asking you three options that you have, do not give an option that is outrightly unethical. Do not give that option, because that should not be an option. What my friend wrote, if I'll inquire if the boss is right, then hitting his wife is right, I'll not do anything. That is not an option before you. So in the interview case study, leaving the mother and child behind is not an option. So even if UPSC asks you about options, give three options and analyze them by their merits and demerits, leaving the mother and child behind, going only for the interview, is not an option. Do not write that. Write the options. You have three options. One, you call your relatives. That is definitely an option. Second, you skip your interview and you take them to the hospital. That is an option. And third, which I wrote, was an option. Leaving them behind was not an option. So do not write outrightly unethical options in your answers. Then generally the structure should be, the structure must not be monotonous. It should not be that what I am going to tell you now. You should not do that in all of your answers. You should do that in one or two answers and then innovate. Because think creatively. Think what is going to impress the examiner. Do you seriously think you are going, if suppose you are the examiner, will you award marks to somebody who has written exactly in the same structure for the whole paper? Will you? No. So that is why the case studies should be interesting enough for the examiner. So you must write ethical issues, ethical concerns, and then stakeholders, and then options available, and then which option to choose. So this should be the general format, but should not be there for every question. In some questions in which you think that stakeholders, I need not write who are the stakeholders. So for example, in this case study, who are the stakeholders? Obviously, I am the stakeholder and the mother and child are the stakeholders. So there is no need to write like stakeholders, me and this and this. And plus, do not write I, me in the ethics paper, in the case studies. Do not use the words, do not use first person. I'll do that. Do not write that. Write either in passive voice, it should be done, or the manager, the case study will be like that. If you are a manager, yeah, you are a manager and you see that this is happening. So you are an interview candidate and you see that a mother and child are lying on the road. So you write that the mother and child should be taken to the hospital. You write that, or you write ki the best way is to search for the hospital on the way to the interview venue and get the mother and child admitted. So avoid the use of the first person words, I, me, my, in your ethics case studies. And generally, if you will be creative and if you will be innovative, the ethics case studies are very rewarding. And I suggest you to attempt the case study part first, because they are more marks fetching. The static portion you might not know anything about the static portion. So if you attempt the static portion first, it might happen that you take more time. You take 1 hour 45 minutes. You take 1 hour 50 minutes for your static portion. Then definitely you will not be able to complete your paper. And you will leave one or two case studies that will going to be detrimental. So attempt the case study part first and the static part after that in one day. So basically there will be 13 questions in static part and nearly 90 minutes, 1.5 hours. So you have to write 5-6 minutes for every question. So and in static part, the sources are, I follow two sources for ethics static part. One, the Chronicle lexicon. Look, people say that the lexicon is good for case studies, but I did not find that lexicon was good for case studies because it was published in 2013, I think, when the first time the ethics paper was introduced. And it is very outdated in its approach. Now we have seen all the toppers who are writing the way that I just told you. They are getting a better marks than the way the Chronicle lexicon enlists the case studies. So, from lexicon, you prepare the static part. You take up every word of the syllabus and you look for it on the internet. Definitely, you must know the difference between ethics, morals, values. This is all common knowledge that I am telling you, because it is very widely available. It is nothing new. You must know the meaning of every term in your syllabus. Secondly, you must make one line, two line notes for every word which you are going to revise. So for ethics paper, eventually I had 10-12 pages of notes for total ethics, for whole of ethics, which I revised right before my exam. Secondly, if you get some quotes, one or two, just from the yojana that I told. So if you get to use them in the static portion also, that will be very helpful. And even in case studies, just for example, this time the second question on case study was very unconventional. It was three situations were given and you have to write on those. So it was not like a case, actually. It was not a real case, this is happening, what will you do? It was not that. So in such type of unconventional case studies, you can also enter, you can also mention one or two quotes. So for static, you refer to the lexicon and the internet, and then you pick up vision question papers. Vision has four papers for ethics, two part length and two full length. So these four papers were basically my source of content. There are two, three things as far as vision IS test series is concerned. They have, I just told you, they do not use data in their answers. They have good answers. So for certain topics such as GS2 topics of self-help groups and NGOs and all these, if you go for sources, if you go for material like IGNU and NIOS, They are extensive and I do not think they are relevant per se as per the examination. So my sources for ethics and such topics of GS2 like NGO and SSG were Vision IAS test series. So what I did was I picked up question papers of this year and of the last year. So I found out 7-8 questions on NGOs in the Vision test series itself. So those 7-8 questions covered almost all the dimensions for NGOs and SSGs and pressure groups and all these things. So that was my source. So I took those answers, I made bullet points, and I knew that any question for NGO, the topic NGO is there in GS2. What you need to know about NGO is, what is an NGO? What does it do? Its advantages, how can NGOs help the country, the problems with the NGOs, the problems within the NGOs, and the problems the NGOs cause to the country. For example, we see the news that NGOs are an hindrance in developmental activities, such type of, then funding problems with NGOs. So all these things were covered in the Vision IAS test series. So I did not refer to any specific material, any book or something, because the less you read, the more you'll be able to revise. And the more you'll be able to revise, the more marks you'll get. Because the thing with UPSC syllabus is that it is a very interesting, very, very interesting syllabus. So you always have the feeling of intellectual pleasure. Whatever you read, you will feel that I am now a more intellectual person, I am now a more knowledgeable person. So, but the problem is that we do not transfer that knowledge. We are not able to transfer that knowledge to the answer sheet. So when we read the Hindu articles, what happens is we read an article and we feel, wow, isse acha article to ho hi nahi sakta. UPSC, main is article ko pura rat leta hun, I'll mug up the article. And when UPSC ask the question, I'll vomit right there. As it is, itta hum soch lete hain. Have you ever seen a question in UPSC that can be answered by a single article? They'll not be one. So what you should derive from that article is one single line, or two lines, or three lines at best. So any article that you are coming across in newspaper should give you two or three lines, two or three points that you are going to use in your answers. So this you will be able to make up single page notes. I had single page notes for almost all the issues. For international relations, I had one page bullet points, bullet topics. And for ethics, I told you I had 9-10 page handwritten notes, jisme har word ka meaning likha hua tha, uska implications likha hua tha, uske aur jo offshoots do teen baatein hain wo likhi hui thi. So by that you will be able to have some 9-10, 20-30, 40 pages of your handwritten notes right before mains. And trust me, the night before mains is the most important one, because at that time, if you will not revise your whole syllabus, you will not be confident in the exam. And if you have not made single page notes, or I mean, if you are comfortable with thicker notes, then also, but I was comfortable with one single page notes. So if I revised those notes right before my exam, and I was able to deliver that in the exam as well. So all these things can be carried to the examination hall, and you can deliver what you are. You can present to the exam, because I do not think, I think you are as, all of you are as good as me and good enough to be an administrator. No, anybody who has taken up the preparation of civil services is bold enough to be an administrator, is good enough to be an administrator. The difference is how much are we able to translate ourselves into the examination hall, into the interview. So this is the overall gist. One more thing that I like to add is, whenever you feel any problem, whenever you feel that you might not be able to make it, or you feel depressed, the thing that comes to your help is your circle. So have a good circle. Do not be friends with people who will just keep on having a negative bent of mind. I partied a lot. I partied almost every weekend. I went for movies. I mean, I don't like movies as such, but I watched movies. I watched Game of Thrones and all this. I was just a normal guy. That's what I'm telling you. I was not a serious student. I was a sincere student. So you have your circle with positive frame of mind. You have your circle which keeps on pushing you, which keeps on motivating you. Do not have friends who drag you down, because there will be a tendency in people who are not performing as good as you, or people who are performing better than you, being afraid of you that you will one day perform better than you, better than him. So such type of people will try to drag you down. Do not spend much time with them. Stay away from negative thoughts. Stay motivated. Staying motivated is a very crucial part, because the journey is long. The journey is full of obstacles. And if you are not able to motivate yourself every day when you wake up, it is going to be a very difficult task to clear the examination. So keep a good circle. And as far as basics are there, every time I felt that something is not working out for me. For example, just last example, in 2016 prelims, I felt that I did not know anything about economy. So economy was a very challenging part for me, because all the other subjects, polity ke liye Lakshmikant available hai, history ke liye spectrum is there, NCRTs are very good. One more thing, NCRTs. Read all the NCRTs. You cannot clear the exam without reading NCRTs. If any topper is saying he cleared the exam without reading the NCRTs, he is lying. You cannot clear the exam without having read the NCRTs. Read the NCRTs from class 6 to class 12. Do not think is 6th class ki NCRT to bachcha padhta hai. The knowledge that is there will help you in attempting, and I said there is no such thing as 6th class and 5th class and 10th class. Write an essay like a school kid and you will get marks, because it will be simple. We try to make things complex to get good marks, right? So read all the NCRTs. History, polity and geography are there. 9th and 10th ka old NCRT world history are very good. Or themes in Indian history, three books are there of NCRT history books. Those are very good. Then introductory macroeconomics for economy, 12th class NCRT. So except for 1-2 NCRTs, like the new NCRTs of class 9th and 10th of history, that I did not find very relevant. But except for a few NCRTs, almost all the NCRTs, they are going to be your Bible, Gita or Quran, whatever. They are what you will learn from. They are what you will carry to the exam. They are what that will make you an IAS. The NCRTs are the must. So overall, I like to say that the example I was quoting, economy. So I was very underprepared for economy. Did not know a single thing about economy. Very frightened ki what will happen, because 10-15 questions are there. From economy, 4-5 static questions are there, 10-12 current affairs questions are there from economy. So in such a frightening scenario, again that warrior mode comes in picture, and you just face it. You go today and pick up the most difficult thing that you find, and you read it, and it will no longer be a challenge to you. It will no longer be difficult. Economy was difficult for me because I did not read it. So I studied from the videos of Mrunal sir, jo available hai economy ka, YouTube ke upar available hai. 55 videos are there. You pick them out. 30 days are left for prelims. You pick 20-25 are good. If you do one video of half an hour daily, so you'll be able, economy ke liye, you'll be able to cover up all the economy part for prelims, and in mains it will be also very helpful. So basically, the approach that I followed was, whenever you falter at any point, you go back to your basics, you pick up the most basic thing you have read about that topic, you read it again, you stay motivated, and you keep the spirit, you keep the flame burning alive in you, because these three things, back to basics, you keeping staying motivated, and fighting like a warrior with the examination, are the most crucial and most essential things to clear the exam. Next, I'll put up a blog, or I'll put up an email ID. You can ask me specific questions which you are facing, because I know that there are many things, because toppers come and they blah blah blah, they lecture, okay, that is not very relevant. So you just ask me your specific questions, I'll be able to answer them. I'll be able to tell you what worked for me. I might not be able to tell you what will work for you, but I'll be able to give you an insight to find out what might work for you. Okay, so all the best, keep on studying. I wish you all the very best. I hope that all of you will join the government as civil servants and will work for the betterment of the country. All the very best. Thank you. Okay, now Abhijit will come up and he'll give you such tips for prelims. He has scored 160 marks in prelims 2016. I scored 110. 50 marks more knowledge is sitting right there. And this time also he's expecting more than 130 or 150. 150. This time also he's expecting, this time paper, the cutoff just released now. 105 is the cutoff for this year prelims. And he scored 150. 50 marks above cutoff in prelims examination. So you pound upon him and you ask him all your doubts which are there as far as prelims is concerned. Okay, thank you.